العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا وسيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما، اللهم آمين. So alhamdulillah, in the previous lesson we completed the first part of the book, which was الاستدلال على إثبات الأسماء والصفات من القرآن, which was to use the Quran as an evidence for the beautiful names and the lofty attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So in today's lesson, we begin speaking about the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla that are mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. And the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, Shaykh Islam Taymiyyah, he first begins by clarifying the importance of the Sunnah, the status of the Sunnah, and how the Sunnah supports the Quran. Then after that, he begins by mentioning some of these attributes. He begins by mentioning these attributes. So he says, فصلٌ, يعني chapter. He says, ثم في سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فالسنة تفسر القرآن وتبينه وتدل عليه وتعبر عنه. He says, رحمه الله تعالى, ثم في سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then in the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. يعني these attributes can be found. He says, فالسنة تفسر القرآن وتبينه وتدل عليه وتعبر عنه. He says that the Sunnah explains the Quran. يعني تفسر القرآن explains the Quran. وتبينه clarifies the Quran. وتدل عليه indicates to the Quran, is an indication of the Quran. وتعبر عنه, and it speaks about the Quran or paraphrases the Quran, or يعني we can say to يعني تعبر عنه, it further explains the Quran. And the Sunnah is al-aslu thani, يعني الذي يجب الرجوع إليه بعد كتاب الله. So the Sunnah is the second masdar and the second source of revelation. The first source of revelation is the Quran, as you all know. And the second source of revelation is the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is obligatory for us to believe in the Sunnah, just like it is wajib upon us to believe in the Quran. In fact, the hujjiyah of the Sunnah, the fact that the Sunnah is a hujjah and an evidence, is something that is known from this religion بالضرورة, by necessity. By ماذا? Necessity. And the Sunnah and the Quran are both in the same bracket, are both in the same category when it comes to hujjiyah. When it comes to ماذا hujjiyah, when it comes to as يعني an evidence, both the Quran and the Sunnah have the same importance and the same relevance. When it comes to the masdar and the source, يعني by looking at the source, لا شك, the Quran is أرفع, the Quran has a higher status because it is the word of Allah عز وجل, and the Sunnah is the Kalam and the words of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. But when it comes to hujjiyah and the fact that it is an evidence, then both the Quran and the Sunnah are equal. Both the Quran and the Sunnah are equal. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. If you differ in anything, فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ, then take it back to Allah and His Messenger. يعني if you disagree in an issue, then go back to Allah and His Messenger. So الرد إلى الله يكون بالرد إلى الكتاب. Going back to Allah means going back to the book. And going back to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم when he was alive, the Sahaba used to go back to the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and ask him. But after the death of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we go back to ماذا? His Sunnah. Because the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Ala inni utitu al-Qur'ana mithlahu ma'ah." Indeed, I have been given the Quran and that which is equal to it, and that which is similar to it, يعني the Sunnah of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Sunnah, linguistically means a tariqa, a path. And technically, the Sunnah is everything that came or has been mentioned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, everything that came from the message of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his statements, his actions, and his tacit approvals. And the Shaykh al-Islam explains to us the status of the Sunnah by saying, فَالسُنَّةُ تُفَسِّرُ الْقُرْآنِ. The Sunnah explains the Quran, meaning تُبَيِّنُهُ وَتُبَيِّنُ مَعَانِيهِ, meaning that the Sunnah explains the ma'ani, the meanings that are in the Quran, وَمَقَاصِدِهِ, and the objectives of the Quran. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, and we have revealed for you the dhikr. The dhikr, يعني the sunnah, okay? We have revealed the sunnah to you. The dhikr here, it means the sunnah. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ. We have revealed the dhikr to you, لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, so that you may clarify to the people, مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, that which was revealed to them from the Quran. So this is in Surah An-Nahl, verse 44. This ayah is very clear in the fact that it tells us that the sunnah was revealed by Allah. It came down from Allah, meaning it is a wahy. Meaning it's wahyun yutla. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. The Prophet doesn't speak out of hawa and desires. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Indeed, it is a wahy, revelation that was revealed to him. So this ayah in Surah An-Nahl, verse 44, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرُ. We have revealed to you the dhikr. We have revealed to you the sunnah. The sunnah here is referred to as dhikr because it is the dhikr, it is remembrance. Okay, لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ. Why? لَامْ هُنَا لَامْ تَعْلِيمِ, يعني so that you may clarify to the people مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, that which was ماذا revealed to them. And then he says, وَالسُنَّةُ, he says, تُفَسِّرُ الْقُرْآنُ وَتُبَيِّنُهُ. يعني تُبَيِّنُهُ means that it clarifies its مُجْمَلَات. يعني السنة تبين ما أجمل في القرآن. The Sunnah clarifies that which has been left ambiguous in the Quran. So an example of this is قوله تعالى وأقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة. طيب, Allah says establish the prayers, but He doesn't actually explain to us in the Quran how to establish the prayers. This is mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, he says, "Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli." Pray as though you've seen me, the way you've seen me pray. So the Sunnah similarly, zakah, the Quran tells us to pay the zakah, but it doesn't tell us how. The nisab, the يعني, what are the conditions of paying the zakah? And there are many masail and issues that are missing that are well known in the Sunnah. Similarly, Allah Azza wa Jalla, with regards to Hajj, He says, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ. Allah says, and for Allah, upon the people, is to do Hajj and pilgrimage to the house. How does this pilgrimage work? What are the conditions of this pilgrimage? What are the arkan and the pillars of this pilgrimage? We do not know from the Quran, but we know ماذا from the Sunnah. So that's what it means when that's what the Shaykh means when he says فَالسُنَّةُ تُبَيِّنُ الْقُرْآنِ, يعني it clarifies the Quran. طيب, and then he says وَتَدُلُّ عَلَيْهِ وَتَدُلُّ عَلَيْهِ وَتُعَبِّرُ عَنْهُ, يعني meaning that the Sunnah explains to us, it indicates to the Quran, it's an indication of the Quran, and it paraphrases ماذا Quran. Meaning there are some masail issues that are mentioned in the Quran, and they are mentioned in more detail ماذا in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he says, رحمه الله تعالى, وما وصف الرسول به ربه عز وجل من الأحاديث الصحاح التي تلقاها أهل المعرفة بالقبول وجب الإيمان بها كذلك. So he says that whatever that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم described in the authentic أحاديث, الأحاديث الصحاح, those أحاديث in which the people of معرفة, يعني the people of knowledge, have understood and have accepted, okay, have learned and accepted, بالقبول يعني accepted, these أحاديث that contain the names and the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, وجب الإيمان بها كذلك, it is obligatory for us to believe in them as they are, or in their apparent meaning, without distorting them, without distorting them, trying to change their meanings, trying to reject them without rejecting them, etc. Okay? Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَمَا يَنْتَقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. So the sunnah, the sunnah in which the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoke with, okay, it is a wahyun min Allah. It is ماذا? Wahyun, a revelation from Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَأَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Surah An-Nisa, verse 113, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَأَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Allah has revealed to you the kitab, يعني the Quran, والحكمة, and the sunnah. The hikmah here means ماذا? The sunnah. Also, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, يعني regarding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. يعني whatever the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought to you, whatever he taught you, فَخُذُوهُ, take it, learn it, apply it. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever he has prohibited you from doing, فَانْتَهُوا, then abstain from it, refrain from doing it. Right? Then he says, مِنَ الْأَحَادِيثِ الصِّحَاحِ. So صِحَاح is the plural of صحيح, يعني الحديث الصحيح. And a hadith that is صحيح, in according to the scholars of مصطلح الحديث, a hadith is deemed as sahih if it meets five conditions. A hadith is deemed and considered as a sahih, graded as sahih, authentic. Okay, the highest level of authenticity is sahih. Then the second level of authenticity is hasan. So this is the first level of authenticity, sahih. And a hadith is considered sahih if it meets five conditions. The first of these conditions is adalatul ruwat, is that all the narrators in the chain have to be trustworthy, have to be better trustworthy. The second condition is dhabt al-ruwat, they all have to have precision in memory. All of them have to be precise in their memory. The third condition is ittisal al-sanad. All of them have to have met each other, okay? The sanad, the chain has to be connected, connection of the chain, meaning they all have to have met each other. The fourth is as-salamatu min al-illah. The chain and the sanad, meaning the chain and the matan of the hadith, subject of the hadith, has to be free from any defects. Has to be free from any defects, whether hidden or apparent. It has to be free from all defects. And the fifth condition is as-salamatu min al-shudud. The chain, the hadith itself, يعني the hadith, when we say hadith, we mean the chain of the hadith and the matan of the hadith has to be free from any shudud or abnormalities, has to be free from any abnormalities. Okay? So if these five conditions are met in a hadith, then that hadith is considered to be sahih. That hadith is ماذا? Considered to be sahih. And then now the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, this is like a muqaddima and an introduction to what's going to come. So what he's saying to you as the reader is, all of these ahadith, all of the attributes that are going to be mentioned in this book, they are all from authentic ahadith. So you have to accept them. You have to accept them regardless of what the people of desires claim. Because the people of desires, the people of Ahwa, the people of innovation, اخترعوا بدع جديدة. They have invented new types of innovations in order to reject authentic hadith. One of these innovations is that we don't accept, they say, khabar al ahad. We don't accept hadith that were mentioned without a chain that indicates to tawatur, indicates to the chain that was mentioned by one or two few narrators. So the chain, they say, has to have reached the level of mutawatir, has to be mass distributed. Okay, if it's not mass distributed, then we cannot accept it, and we deem it to be a hadith that was narrated by one individual narrator or two individual narrators, as long as it hasn't reached the level of tawatur. They say that these types of a hadith, even if the narrator even if the hadith fulfills all these five conditions, we cannot accept it. And the reason why they say this is to reject the hadith of sifat, the attribute of a sifat. So the Mu'tazila, the Asha'ira, the Ahlul Kalam, they come with this innovation. So this is why the Shaykh gave this introduction, in order for you to understand the importance of the hadith, in order for you to have in your heart, in order for the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ to be sacred in your heart, to have a high importance matter in your heart. He says, فَمِنْ ذَلِكَ, an example of this, مثل قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم, like Allah's statement, ينزل ربنا إلى سماء الدنيا كل ليلة حين يبقى ثلث الليل الآخر فيقول من يدعوني فأستجيب له من يسألني فأعطيه من يستغفرني فأغفر له. In this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. Okay, so this hadith, hadith al-Nuzul, this famous hadith, which is known as the hadith of descension. Okay, this is a descension. Allah descends to Sama'u dunya, to the dunya, to the lowest heaven of the heaven of this dunya, the lowest sky. Okay, it is a descension that is befitting Allah's majesty. Okay, we believe in it as it is, without trying to distort its meaning, without rejecting it, without trying to understand the meaning itself, without trying to understand exactly how this is going to happen. We don't talk about the how. We believe there is a how, but we don't talk about it, but we believe in it as it is. Okay? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla, and we don't liken Allah or resemble him or compare him to any of his creation or anything at all. Okay? Because Allah says, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ, there is nothing like Allah Azza wa Jalla. Okay? And Allah Azza wa Jalla, the Prophet in this hadith mentions the exact time that Allah will descend. He says Allah will descend when in the last portion of the night, the last third of the night. And then when Allah Azza wa Jalla descends, he says to his slaves, okay, من يدعوني فأستجيب له, who's going to call upon me and supplicate to me so that I may respond to him? من يسألني فأعطيه, who's going to ask of me so that I may give to him? من يستغفرني فأغفر له, who is going to seek my forgiveness? Who is going to rather seek my forgiveness so that I may forgive him? Okay. Nowadays, we see in the UK, especially in some masajid, that there are imams that are have been affected by the madhab of the Ash'ari madhab, and these imams, they pretend and they try to come across as being upon the correct aqidah. They come across as being according to, they come across and they pretend to be upon the correct aqidah. Okay, and when they are faced with the hadith, this type of hadith, okay, they try to lower the importance of the hadith. They say things that can be misunderstood to reject the hadith. So they say things such as, we shouldn't pay attention to the first portion of the hadith, but rather we should pay attention to the last portion of the hadith, which is to supplicate to Allah Azza wa Jal in the last third of the night so that Allah forgives our sins. But let's not talk about the first part of the hadith. So they do what's known as tafweed. They do what's known as tafweed. So this is how they introduce the hadith. And this is how they prepare the listener to reject the hadith itself. So they know the importance of the first part of the hadith. So be careful of these people. Okay? And some of them, they say, for example, that we don't know what is this nuzul. This nuzul can mean many things. We don't know what it is. Okay, this is ta'wil, and this is the madhab of the Asha'ira. If anyone says this, be careful of this person. Okay, because the aqidah has a question mark all over it. Okay, but the Salafi, the Sunni, the person, ماذا? The Salafi and the Sunni is the one who explains the hadith similar to the explanation of our ulama, of the Sahaba, the explanation of the Tabi'un, the Atba'u Tabi'un, and the ulama of Salaf. Yuthbituna sifat al-Nuzul. They affirm for Allah the attribute of Nuzul. So al-Nuzulu is sifatun min sifati, it's an attribute of Allah Azza wa Jalla. But we don't know the kayfiyyah. We don't know how Allah will descend. But that's not to say that we are disbelieving in the how. We affirm that there is a how, there is a kayfiyyah. But we don't know exactly what this kayfiyyah is, لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى لَمْ يَتَعَبَّدْنَا بِذَلِكَ. Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He did not request us to know the how. He requested from us to believe in it. That's it. And we believe in it. نُمِرُّهَا كَمَا جَاءَتْ بِلَا كَيْفْ أَزَلَوْ زَعِسَتْ. We understand it as it is without going into the كيف. بِلَا كَيْفٍ يَعْقِلُهُ الْبَشَرْ, he means. Without talking about the كيف, and without trying to compare Allah Azza wa Jal to His makhluqat, to His creation. طيب. So the nuzul is a sifa min sifatihi. It is a min sifati al-af'al. It is from the attributes that are the action attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal. So nuzul is not an attribute that is connected to Allah's essence. It is an attribute that is connected to Allah's ma'ala nuzul. To Allah's ma'ala nuzul, يعني to Allah's af'al. It's an attribute that is connected to Allah's ma'ala actions. Okay? And in this hadith also, fihi ithbatul ulu. Okay? This hadith also affirms the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal is the most high. Is the ma'ala the most high. So yanzilu rabbuna, Allah descends. So he was in a place that was high, and then he ma'ala descended. But that doesn't mean that when Allah descends, that there are things that will be above Allah Azza wa Jal from His creation. So we don't do qiyas. We don't compare Allah Azza wa Jal to the creation. Okay? Because we know, for example, when something descends from the cloud, let's say an airplane, a plane descends from the clouds, is above the clouds. Okay? When it descends, the clouds then are above it. Then the more it descends, when it lands, then even buildings are above it, right? This is what we know, that when something, an object descends, then that object is descending from somewhere high to somewhere low. And the people of Kalam, the people of innovation, they say, how can you describe Allah Azza wa Jal with something like this? How can you describe Allah to be coming from high to low? Okay? And because of this shubha, they say that the nuzul here is yanzil, Allah doesn't descend, but rahmatuhu tanzil. They say that يعني Allah's rahmah descends, or His amr, His command descends. Okay, some of them even say He's the angel descends. Okay, this can be easily refuted from the hadith itself, because the hadith says Allah descends, okay, يعني, to the lowest heaven, to the heaven of the dunya, okay. And then he says, من يدعوني, who's going to make dua to me? فأستجيب له, من يسألني فأعطيه. How can Allah's rahmah claim say this? هل يعقل, يعني that Allah's rahmah, Allah's amr, Allah's, one of his, Allah's angels will say, من يدعوني, who's going to supplicate to me? فأستجيب له, so that I may answer his supplication. Who's going to ask me, so that I may give to him? Do you think that an angel would dare to say this? Do you think Allah's rahmah, His command, His amr would say this? Of course not. Okay? So the hadith itself refutes this shubha very pretty easily. So the only way out of this shubha is to believe that Allah descends. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, He descends in a manner that is befitting His majesty. In a manner that is befitting His majesty and His يعني his lofty highness. Okay, so that's with regard to sifat al-nuzul. Then we move on to the next sifa, which is sifatul farah wal dhahik. Okay, this hadith affirms that يعني for Allah Azza wa Jal, the attribute of happiness and the attribute of laughter, of dhahik. Okay, we know from the creation what happiness is. We know what happiness is. We know that the human beings get happy. We know ماذا that human beings get laugh. Okay. But ليس كمثله شيء. You need to understand this. There's nothing similar to Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay? The only similarity, as Ibn Abbas said, the only similarity between the names and attributes of Allah and the names and the attributes of the creation is the name itself. Okay? Is the name of the attribute itself. That's the only similarity. An example of this is Jannah. Allah Azza wa Jal tells us that in Jannah, there are rivers of water. There are rivers of يعني honey. There are rivers of milk. But the milk is in Jannah is not like the milk in this dunya. The water in Jannah is not like the water in this dunya. The khamr and the alcohol in Jannah, the khamr that's in Jannah, is not like the alcohol and the khamr in this dunya. Okay? شَتَّانَ مَا بَيْنَهُمَا. Okay? And there's no similarity whatsoever because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that indeed in Jannah, فِي الْجَنَّةِ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. In Jannah, there are things that no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, and no human heart has ever comprehended. That's in Jannah. Okay? So that if that's the case for Jannah, which is something that is created on a makhluq, then فَمَا بَالُكَ بِاللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Allah Azza wa Jal, that who we've never seen how he looks like. Okay? We know that Allah Azza wa Jal, his attributes are attributes of perfection. Okay? They are limitless in their power. All right? So the fact that Allah laughs, we don't know how that laughter is. We don't know the how. We affirm there is a how. Be careful here. When we say نَحْنُ لَا نَعْرِفُ الْكَيْفِيَّةِ نَحْنُ لَا يَعْنِي ذَلِكَ أَنَّنَا نُلْغِي الْكَيْفِيَّةِ لَا يَعْنِي ذَلِكَ أَنَّنَا نَجْحَدْ الْكَيْفِيَّةِ. Okay, very important here. When we say we do not know how Allah laughs, how Allah is happy, that doesn't mean we are rejecting the how. That doesn't mean we are cancelling the how. We believe there is a how. We believe that Allah laughs, and He laughs in a manner that is befitting His majesty. He knows. But we believe in the attribute itself. We affirm the attribute. We affirm the attribute. We affirm the howness and the kayfiyah. But we negate and we don't know the howness. We don't know ourselves. This is because of our limited knowledge. Allah didn't give us this knowledge. Allah told us that He laughs and that He is ماذا pleased. Okay? He laughs and He is pleased and happy. But He didn't tell us how this is going to happen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, لَاللَّهُ أَشَدُّ فَرَحًا بِتَوْبَةِ عَبْدِهِ مِنْ أَحَدِكُمْ بِرَاحِلَتِهِ. Indeed, Allah is most happy with the tawbah of His servant who lost his luck, who lost his provisions on top of a camel and then found his provisions and the camel itself. So this is the story of this hadith goes that there is a servant, a person who's traveling by camel, and he has all of his food and water and provisions on top of the camel. And then he goes to sleep, and then his camel, he's in the middle of the desert, and his camel disappears. He doesn't know where his camel is. He has his water, everything is on the camel, his provisions are on the camel, and he doesn't know where it is. So he's facing certain death. He looks and looks and looks and looks and looks, and he doesn't find it until he despairs of ever finding it. And then he submits to the will of Allah Azza wa Jalla that he's going to die. And then he goes to sleep underneath a tree. And then he wakes up all of a sudden to find his camel standing on top of him with the provisions, with the water and the food. And then this servant, he's so happy that he says, Allah, Allahumma anta abdi wa ana rabbu. In his sheer happiness, he says, he makes a mistake. أقطع من شدة الفرح. He makes a mistake and he says, oh Allah, you are my slave and I am your Lord. He made a mistake. He wanted to thank Allah. He was so happy that he made a mistake. So the hadith is saying that Allah is more happy, is happier to see his servant repenting after a sin than this man, than the happiness of this man who just found his provisions after, and on top of his camel after يعني after يعني يعني despairing and knowing that he's facing certain death. Okay, so here this hadith affirms al-farah lillah, affirms that Allah is pleased and happy. Okay, this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. And the second hadith is the Prophet saying, يَضْحَكُ اللَّهُ إِلَى رَجُلَيْنِ يَقْتُلُ أَحَدُهُمَ الْآخَرُ كِلَاهُمَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ. Allah Azza wa Jalla laughs at two men or at the situation of two men. One of them kills the other, but both of them enter Jannah. Okay, this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. How do both of them enter Jannah? The hadith tells us that one of them, يعني they are fighting, one of them is a disbeliever and the other is a believer. The one that is a disbeliever, he kills the believer. Yeah, he and the believer becomes a martyr and a shaheed and goes to Jannah. And then this man who was a disbeliever later on believes in Allah, accepts Islam, and then he becomes a good Muslim, and then he dies, and then he also enters Jannah. And what a happy ending, يعني. What a beautiful ending, subhanAllah. So Allah Azza wa Jalla yadhak, Allah Azza wa Jalla is pleased at this. Allah Azza wa Jalla is pleased at this. So we learn from these ahadith, subhanAllah. One of the Sahaba, he said, لَن نَعْدِمَ خَيْرًا مِنْ رَبٍ يَضْحَكْ. One of the Sahaba, he said, لَن نَعْدِمَ خَيْرًا, يعني we will not be, يعني we will always find goodness in a Lord that laughs and smiles, يعني a Lord that laughs. يعني the Sahabi is the Arabi. This is his own istinbat. When he heard this, Arabi, a Bedouin, when he heard this hadith, do you think he made ta'wil of the hadith like the Jahmiyyah and the Mu'tazila and say, how can our Lord laugh? No. He said, we will always find goodness. لَن نَعْدِمَ خَيْرًا. We will never be at a loss of goodness from a Lord that ماذا laughs. So هذه الأحاديث تبشرنا بالخير. يعني يا أخواني, the hadith النزول that we just learned now, the hadith of الفرح, hadith of الضحك, they should instill in us حب العبادة, that loving to worship. We worship Allah because Allah Azza wa Jal, he is happy when we worship Him. He doesn't need our worship. They don't indicate to the fact that Allah needs us, by the way. They don't indicate that Allah needs us. Allah isn't happy because He needs us. No, Allah is happy because of this fact that the servant made tawbah. So when we sin and we make tawbah, then we should always have in the back of our minds or in the front of our minds that Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah ashaddu farahan, that Allah Azza wa Jal is pleased and happy at our tawbah. No matter what the sin is, no matter how big the sin is, okay, Allah's maghfirah and His rahmah is bigger than our sins. Okay, this is why Allah Azza wa Jal says, ghafiru al-dhanbi muqabilu tawbah. Ghafiru al-dhanbi, na'am. Ghafiru al-dhanbi waqabil al-tawbah. Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who accepts, who forgives sins and accepts tawbah. Okay, so whenever we sin, we should remember this. Okay, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Qul ya 'ibadi alladhina asrafu 'ala anfusihim la taqnatu min rahmatillah. Inna Allaha yaghfiru adh-dhunuba jami'a." Say to my servants who have transgressed against themselves with sins, whether minor or major sins, do not despair of the mercy of Allah. Okay, indeed Allah forgives all sins. So when we make tawbah, يعني for Allah to forgive a major sin, we have to make tawbah. For Allah to forgive a minor sin, then we have to do righteous actions. Okay? Oh, and tawbah is also good. And the Prophet ﷺ used to make tawbah to Allah Azza wa Jal more than 100 times in a day. This Prophet, whom Allah Azza wa Jal has forgiven all of his prior sins, all of his future sins, makes tawbah, used to make tawbah to Allah Azza wa Jal more than 100 times in a day. فَنَحْنُ مِنْ بَابِ أَوْلَى. We should be making tawbah even more. Okay? So we'll not have ended this hadith. We'll stop here, inshallah ta'ala, and we'll continue from Sifat Al-Ujub, inshallah, next week from Sifat Al-Ujub. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. If anyone has any questions, then I'm going to give you a few minutes to ask your question. You can take yourself off mute and ask, okay? Or you can type. The reference, someone's asking, is it possible to get a reference for the statement of Ibn Abbas regarding Allah's name and attributes? Barakallahu feekum. Write this in Telegram, and I will write this question in Telegram, and I will respond in Telegram, inshallah. The Quran, the main source, someone's asking, the Quran, the main source of evidence for the names and attributes of Allah and the Sunnah. Well, with the Sunnah used to support this, or are there some names that are only found in the Sunnah? There are some names and attributes like النزول that are only found in the Quran and the Sunnah. Like these attributes now, النزول, الضحك, الفرح, they can only be found in the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. نعم. So both of them are considered sources, the Quran and the Sunnah. Okay. نعم. I think that's the end of the questions. طيب بارك الله فيك إن شاء الله. We're going to stop here and I will, إن شاء الله تعالى, will continue from next Saturday, same time. بارك 10:15 AM. جزاكم الله خيرا. صلى الله وسلم.
وقل رب زدني علما.